Good morning and welcome to Community Life Church. I'm Kat Seiler, the Director of Discipleship here. We are so glad you decided Sunday morning. I know things at my house are a little crazy on Sunday, and so we want to give you an extra 60 seconds to go grab that cup of coffee. Maybe you could text a friend or a family member and ask them to join us. And we also want to remind you to grab your elements for communion today. Ready, set, go. Welcome back. We'd like to start this portion of this service by joining our hearts together in praying the Lord's Prayer. Will you pray with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Father God, thank you for this beautiful morning. Thank you for the opportunity to gather together. Even though we're spread out all over the community, all over the state and our country, we have this amazing opportunity to join together, join our hearts together and worship you and honor you. Father, times right now are absolutely crazy and they can be trying at times, but you are steadfast. You are the rock. You are the steadiness in that storm. And we thank you for that, Father. We give today up to you, and we do all this in your Son, Jesus Christ's most holy and precious name. Amen.
Well, good morning. We are so thankful that you're here watching and joining us for worship. I just want to encourage you this morning. We really do believe with all of our hearts that God shows up when we all join together in worship. And it's not about this building. It's about us joining our hearts together. And so I want to encourage you to do that with us this morning. We're going to start off with this hymn that I know that you'll know, Holy, Holy, Holy. And let's just really open our hearts and see what God has in store for us today.
Holy, holy, holy. Lord God Almighty, early in the morning, our soul shall rise to thee. Holy, 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 merciful.
Praise.
This morning, we are so thankful that you defeated death, because we believe that you're more than just a story that we read about in the Bible. God, you are real. We believe that the words in the Bible are true and real and alive. It's living. And if that's the case, Lord, when you defeated death, you gave us freedom, you gave us victory. And you live and dwell inside of us, which means we have the same power, Lord, because you were raised from the dead, Lord, that same power lives and breathes and moves inside of us today. And so we have the ability to overcome those challenges in life, those things that hold us back, that keep us down, that fear that causes us to not always walk in those things that you've called us to walk into. So help us this morning, Lord, to really grab hold of that freedom that you already paid, the price that you already paid for us. We love you. We open up our hearts. We know that you come, Lord, with a plan and a purpose today, and we want to be a part of that. We thank you for being here and for your presence being so real and close to us this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Continue to move in our hearts today. We believe it. Amen. Thank you so much for singing with us this morning.
Well, good morning and welcome to Community Life Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. My name is Scott Veroneau, and I'm the lead pastor here at Community Life. And it is an honor to have you here with us today. Number one, I can't say community. And number two, my thing, it made like a weird sound, so I hope we're all good. But I do want to thank you so much for being here with us today. At Community Life, we love God, we love our neighbor, and we believe that our mission is to connect people to Jesus. And so that's the way that we've created our ministry and how we resource our ministry, because we believe that Jesus is the source of life. And so if you're struggling today and you're just dealing with life and the issues of life, we would love to just walk alongside you in whatever that looks like. If you wanna send us an email, prayer@clc.life or cares@clc.life, and just let us know, and we'd love to be there for you. We have our Feeding Florida program that we've been hosting here at the church for the last few months. We have now moved that into other churches in the community and are going to facilitate that in a different way. And so we will not have our feeding program tomorrow, but if you are in need of resource, use those two emails that I gave you, one of the two, and we'll be able to reach back out to you, cares@clc.life, and we'll get you plugged in and we'll find a place for you to get what you need to continue on in that. Hope everybody's doing good today. This Sunday has been pretty crazy from the start. And the last thing in the 9 o'clock service, we literally had one of our modems go down. And so everybody's been scrambling around, and Lee's been running around and popping up in different areas. And we now have iPads, and we're trying to have all sorts of redundancy. But if you have glitch issues, I apologize for that. We're going to do the best we can just to keep on trucking along. It's just amazing how things end up working. So say a little prayer and it's all going to be great. Well, we are in a series on prayer, and this is actually the last Sunday for this series, where we have just been kind of going through and talking about some of the understandings and awarenesses of praying. And we started off our first 2 weeks looking specifically at the Sermon on the Mount and what Jesus had to say about prayer, our heart behind how we should pray. And then also he gave us the Lord's Prayer, I believe, as a pattern for us to follow when we sit down to pray, not specifically as a prayer that maybe we do at the beginning of the service where it's a rote prayer, it's a prayer that we say, which is great because we use that to get our hearts together. But it's also a way to sit down and just follow it as a pattern to connect to God. Because if we believe, this is why this series is so important, if we believe that our mission is to connect people to Jesus, then we ought to talk about the one thing that really is our means of communication, prayer, to connecting to Jesus. And so that's what this series is all about. And my hope is that we just start somewhere. And you know, I'll just go ahead and say on the front side of the message that I believe that today's part of the message is so vitally important. And I think it'll have something to say to your heart to really prepare you and to allow you to push into an area of prayer that maybe you've been hesitant to push into. And so I think that this message today will be really meaningful to so many folks. So what we did after those first 2 weeks is really then anchor ourselves in Psalm 139. And we made a decision to do that because it really pulls our hearts together literally on the same sheet of paper, reading through David's Psalm, which covers so many of the deep theological awarenesses of God. But then also today, you're gonna see a little shift in the message that brings us right into it, the relevant side. That's what I believe this message is gonna be so relevant today. So just to kind of recap a little bit, in Psalm 139, the first six verses speaks to David's awareness of a God that knows him And as we sit down and as we pray and we read through this, we could truly say, God, you know me. And then the next few verses, 7 through 12, same thing. God, you are there with me. You are present to me in my life. And then finally, last week, 13 through, we went all the way through 18, is the God that made me and the God that is making me, that the process is still unfolding in our lives. And today we're gonna see just a little shift that I think is gonna help us. But I thought I would do something different today that we hadn't done yet. I wanna read for you the entire text. And then I'll pause for a moment just before we get to 19 and jump into that text. But I wanna read for you the text as if it was a prayer, or read it to you so you can consider sitting down and maybe going through these in your own time. And so David writes this in Psalm 139. He says, "O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from far away." God, you know me. You've looked through my heart. You've checked those things out about me. And because you search me, you know me. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all of my ways. God, you know those little idiosyncrasies that I have inside of my life. Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it completely. You know me that well. Verse 5, you hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. God, you surround me. And even though I might be nervous about that, and even though I'm not always perfect or right in the things that I'm doing, you reach out your hand to bless me. Verse 6, such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It's hard for me to even comprehend the God that knows me, all of me, and still wants to bless me. Verse 7, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I'm going with you or if I'm fleeing, God, there's nowhere that I can go that escapes your very presence. You are there. If I ascend to heaven or make my bed in Sheol, as high as I can imagine, as low as I can imagine, God, you're present to both of those areas. If I take the wings of the morning, or if I settle at the farthest limits of the sea, as far to the west or as far to the east as I could possibly imagine, God, you're there. Even at the extremes of life, you are present to me there. And some of you, that may be exactly where you are today. If I say, and even there, your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me fast. Even in those extremes, you're present to me. If I say, surely darkness shall cover me and the light around me become night. Even darkness is not dark to you. The night is as bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you. Even if you find yourself today in the darkest moment of your life, I want you to know that it's not as darkness to God, that God is present to you in that moment. Verses 13 on through the next. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. You formed the rough edges and then you started to knit me together. I praise you for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. That I know very well. God, I praise you. The creation that I see around, the people that I know, how you just brought and put them together, God, it's worthy of praise, what you have created. Wonderful are your works. My frame was not hidden from you. God, I was known to you. When I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth, your eyes beheld my unformed substance, and in your book were written all the days that were formed for me when none of them as yet existed. It's the model by which God puts us together. So yeah, you made me, but you are also still shaping and molding my life. Verses 17 and 18. How weighty to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. I try to count them. They are more than the sand. I come to the end and I am still with you. It's a doxology that pulls everything together. It's hard for me to imagine the God that thinks all of this of me. The God that I'm just starting to wrestle with that awareness. It just blows my mind to think of that God. And then verse 19, and this is where we are today. Then David says this. Oh, that you would kill the wicked, O God, and that the bloodthirsty would depart from me. Those who speak of you maliciously and lift themselves up against you for evil. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. This psalm and this portion of scripture is very interesting. And I'm just gonna go ahead and tell you right up front, this section of scripture, they won't say it, but it freaks biblical scholars out. In fact, many of them, they avoid it. If you were to go and search Psalm 139, you'll find all sorts of information on verses 1 through 18. But if you search for verses 19 through 24, it's very limited information. People are afraid to talk about it. They're not really sure because of the heart that David takes inside of this, where he talks about hatred and where he talks about his enemies and will you kill the wicked? And the way that he deals with that topic, biblical scholars, in light of Jesus, are afraid to touch it because they're not sure what to say about it. And so a lot of times they just gloss over it, they say what they need to, and they just kind of move on in it. And here's what I would say. To me, shouldn't be surprising. In fact, I believe that this section of scripture is absolutely in keeping with all of the other verses, verses 1 through 18. And I'm just gonna spend some time telling you how I think all that unfolds. But here's why, I can just tell you the first reason why off the beginning it doesn't surprise me. So remember, this is David that's putting these words out there. As harsh and as strong as they may sound at the very beginning, this is David that's saying this. And let me just remind you of a little story of David's life. Think back to David, who was a shepherd, who was in charge of taking care of his family's sheep. And as Israel went off to war against the Philistines, David's father left him out with the sheep while the brothers went out to take care of battle. Until one day, the father needed someone to bring food to the front lines, and so he sends David. And David navigates his way all the way through to this particular battleground. And as he shows up, you've got the army of Israel that's lined up on one side of this valley, and on the other side is the army of the Philistines. And out of the ranks of the Philistines comes this big old tall dude. You guys know his name. His name is Goliath. And Goliath just starts shaming the army of Israel. He just starts going off on him. And David is looking around. He's like, what's going on? And nobody in Israel is doing anything about it. They're all just sitting there and they're all listening and they're in fear of this giant, Goliath. And so David eventually just can't stand it. And he literally says, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that would defy the armies of the living God? And I can imagine everybody around him's like, well, dude, shut up. Like, be quiet. You're gonna get us all killed, so don't be saying that, because David was a short little guy, but I can imagine him popping up over the top trying to look to see what was going on with this Goliath guy. But that's his heart. There was somebody that was coming against the army of God and he wanted to go destroy him. He wanted to knock him out because there was nobody that had any right to come against and to fight and try and kill this army because this army represented God. That's the heart of the person who wrote this psalm. The person who went out to battle and who fought and who won and declared victory in the name of God to establish the kingdom and to do all of the things that he did in his time and in his reign. That's the person that writes these words. So why should it be shocking to us that this is what he would write here? But yet biblical scholars are a little bit nervous about dealing with this. And so let me just kind of unpack it for why I think it all threads together. So first off, David spends 18 verses in the very first part of the psalm, interconnecting our relationship or his relationship in this psalm to God. So he interconnects those two relationships. God, you know me. And he talks about those nuances. God, you are with me. And so not only present, but also in spirit. And he deals with all of those things. And then God, you made me. You shaped me, but then you also knit me together. And so it goes through 18 verses of talking about God's relationship to David or God's relationship to believers or to us, I should say. God, you know me. God, you are with me. God, you made me or you are making me. And so doesn't it seem right in that moment that then David would say, so God, let's talk about life. Let's talk about this hot mess that is right in front of me. And David just brings it right into the daily application of what he's struggling with. And inside of that, David maintains the connection to God. Now, it's so interesting to me when you read verses 19 and 20, what David does in these verses. He says, oh, that you would kill the wicked, O God, and the bloodthirsty would depart from me. And so it seems like he's saying something for himself, but notice what he does in verse 20. Those who speak of you maliciously and lift themselves up against you for evil. So David, just like in the rest of the psalm, connects himself and God. And he puts the two things together as if to say, God, your enemy is my enemy. And you can hear him saying that right up front. And if somebody is coming against you, they're coming against me. And so David is taking that seat in this particular moment. God, your enemy is my enemy. And he's being personal and he's being honest and he's putting his heart and he's putting his thought out there. And I'm gonna tell you, this to me is the most relevant part of this entire psalm because it's real. It's real. David is praying his heart and dealing with those things that are trying to kill him, trying to kill his family, and trying to snuff them out. Now, so many biblical scholars try to place this psalm in somewhere in antiquity. They try to guess or figure out where it might fall in his reign or where he was at what age. And it's difficult to say. But even if you just imagine David and the things that he came up against. And that there were so many people throughout his life that were trying to either kill him or take the kingdom or kill his family, and all of those things which would have broken down or broke the plan or the design of God. And so David, as he championed this understanding of God, he also took it into ownership of his own hands. And so you see David impassioned and fighting for the God and the belief in God that he has. And then before we move on, there's a thread that David adds here, a word that he uses, and the word is the word wicked. And this word he drops on the front side where he says, oh, that you would kill the wicked. Now, it's interesting he used that word. In the Hebrew, it's defined as those who oppose God. Now, it just sounds like he's determining who's wicked until you get to the end of the psalm and you realize that David is using God's awareness of wickedness to put forth. And you see him put it out in the front side, but the important thing that we're going to talk about in a little bit is he uses it as a filter for himself. So he's willing to be judged by the very same wickedness that he's calling others out for. So that's important for us to hold on to when you read these words that seem so tough. So you see verses 19 and 20 and how they come together, and David joins his heart to God. Then you get to 21 and 22, and let me be honest with you, these are the verses that cause so much struggle to people who read through Scripture, not just biblical scholars, but the way it's written just seems to rail against maybe the gospel message that we hear and that we know today. But listen to what he says. He says, "Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them my enemies." Now, it's just interesting when you think about this. And I had a little bit of a struggle in the first service explaining this. But to me, this is almost as if David is making a profession of his faith to God. So go with me on this. And you don't have to put the verses back up on the screen, but it's almost as if he said, "Do I not hate those who hate you? You bet I do. Do I not loathe those who rise up against you? Absolutely." Right? And in those words, as maybe negative as they sound, there is a declaration of David's love for or belief in God. That God, I am with you. Right? Like in my heart of hearts, if somebody's coming against you, I'm going after them. And if you I loathe them as well. David is once again making this profession and establishing this belief in God. It seems so weird for us to hear it because it's a profession, but it's a negative profession the way that he says it. It's a not negative against, but it sounds negative in the way that he says it about hate and about loathing. And then you get to verse 22. This one in the Hebrew it's insane. In the Hebrew, there's only five words that make up this particular verse. He says, "I hate them with a perfect hatred. I count them my enemies." There's five words in the Hebrew that make this up. Three of the words are hate, and enemy. And one of the words is a qualifier for the word hate. So when you read it, there's not much left that's in the verse. That verse can say it only one way. I hate with a perfect hatred those people that would come against God. That's what David is saying in this particular moment. Now, what biblical scholars try to do, and what many people try to do, is they try to take the word hate and they try to soften it, that maybe David meant something else. Like maybe this word means something else. And so I went back in the Hebrew and I looked up this word, and the word is sene in the Hebrew, and the word hate, sene, means hate. It's the literal core word for hate. You can't get any other word for hate. It is clear and straightforward for what David is saying in this particular moment. So it's awfully funny when David says, when he chooses to use a phrase and say a perfect hatred. It's like adding a hate on the front of it. I mean, it's just really weird how he does it. It's almost like saying I double dog hate you, or I hate them with the utmost hate. Never used the word hate that many times in a sermon. But here it is. David is using it in here to declare his love for God and his willingness to fight against those things that would try to come against him. To me, is so relevant. I mean, it's so relevant because it seems like this is exactly where we might find ourselves if we're honest. And when we think about praying and we start to open up our hearts and we start to bear how we're feeling about something, it's honest what David is saying here. God, you're awesome. You know me. You're with me. You made me. And since we're on the same team, why don't you deal with these issues that are trying to take me out? These issues that as a believer, you mold, you shape me, you have me understanding this place, but they're trying to steal my faith, or they're trying to do these things. God, help me to deal with those. I oppose those things. I hate those things that try to destroy me. But here's the thing that makes all of this work. As hard as those four verses are, and as tough as they are to hear, the next two verses to me are the things that make them all work. Verse 23, David says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my thoughts. See if there is any wicked way in me." This is where he invites God in. "And lead me in the way everlasting." You know, it's so powerful to me that when David started to write the very beginning of this psalm, he says, "God, you search me and you have known me." And so my awareness is even before I knew you, God, you knew me because you were already searching me. And here we get back to verse 23. And the difference here is that David is inviting God to do the searching. No longer has God just searched me. God, I want you to search me. I want to be a willing participant in going through this refining process. God, search me, know my heart. I invite you to come in to do a deep work inside of me and see if there is any wicked way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. This is that invitation for transformation inside of David's life. He uses this word wickedness even in terms of his own self. If there's something inside of me, God, I pray that you would bring it out. And he does it in terms of lead me in the way of everlasting. That word everlasting in the Hebrew is to transcend time, to include past and future. It's eternity or eternal or without end. And so David invites God now into the process. So you know me, you're with me, you made me and you are still making me. God, here are the things that are in front of me. Use me, God, and the things that are challenging me, I wanna blot those things out. But God, if there's something inside of my heart that's wrong, I pray that you search me and help me to get that out. I wanna join my heart to you, Lord, in this process. Great section of scripture. So real, so honest. And this is one of the things that I think most people love about David, love about studying David, is that you don't have to dig real far to find somebody who is human and who is human and trying to serve God, known as a man with a heart after God. And so why would we struggle so much with this, knowing that David just puts it all out there for God to hear? Now you may say, Scott, what's the big point? Right, like pulling all of this together, what might you hear in these last few verses that would jump off the page to you? And as I wrestled with this throughout the week, you know, I have a fear in life that maybe we've turned our Christianity in many regards into a pile of platitudes, right? Like we figured out how to have an answer for things, or we silently get together and we pray, and there's a posturing to that's so careful, and you know, just the way that we do those things and how we carry ourselves. And it almost seems like we have platitudes for the ways that we're going to live our Christian faith, and our Christian faith becomes just something that's a part of our life and not necessarily our life in its entirety. And so you might say, Scott, what's the big point to all of this? Here's what I hope for you, and I hope for me, is that in this psalm that we would see, and that maybe we would grab a hold of the passion and the heart that David has in his prayer. Because what David does in this moment is he recognizes the battle that he's fighting. Now for him, it might've been a physical battle with people, but for us in our lives, there are things every single day that are trying to snuff out our faith, that are trying to snuff out our life, that are trying to steal from us the relationship that God has given us. And I just wonder what would happen if we were impassioned about the way that we prayed and we said, God, help me to deal with these things that are trying to take me out. This cancer that's in my life, or this COVID that seems to have changed everything else. God, deal with it ever so severely. with the relationships that I'm struggling with, and maybe the way that I process that through the brokenness. Help to blot out those broken things in my life so that I can be whole in your life. The jealousy that I deal with, God, blot that out inside of me. The fear, the anxiety that I struggle with every single day of my life. God, deal with that stuff in a way that gets it out of my life. Get rid of it. God, that you would blot those things out. God, that you would kill that wickedness that tries to destroy me. The addictions that seem to always come back into my life. God, kill those things dead so that every single day they don't take something from me or steal something from my family. What would happen if we got to that place in our prayer life? Right, and we were, and there's a, it just drives me so bananas. Right, I understand that we get to this place of being meek and mild, and man, I encourage you, when you get into your prayer closet, there is nothing you're gonna say that's gonna knock God off the throne. And if it does, you got the wrong God. There's nothing you're gonna say that's gonna knock God off the throne. This David pouring out his heart is exactly where we should be in our prayer life, as God continues to mold and continues to shape us. And when we're willing to do that, and remember the most important part, which is verse 23, that when we get to that place and we say, God, you hear all of that. Now, I pray this, if my thought is wrong on that, that you would search me and that you would sift me and that you would allow my life, those things that are wickedness inside of me, to get out and lead me in a way everlasting. What would happen if we prayed that prayer? And I'm gonna tell you, it's a dangerous prayer to get into your closet and say, God, search me. And if there's any wickedness, if there's any brokenness inside of me, Lord, I pray that you would get it out. If we prayed that prayer, we'd be very dangerous for all of the right reasons. For all of the right reasons. You know, I think of those in terms of your personal life and what you're walking through. And maybe for some of you, you need this spiritual shot in your arm to just go press in. God knows you. He knows everything about you. God has been with you even when you didn't know, all the way to your farthest extremes. God made you and he's still making you. And I want you to know that he is engaged with you, with what is right in front of you in your life. And this is the time when you can bow your head and you can press in and you can say, God, help me to blot these things out that are trying to take what you have so intended for me. My faith, my family, those things, God, let's go deal with them. And search me and help me to make sure that I am right where I need to be in my life. And you know, when I think about all of this, it's a throwback, or it's a throw forward, I should say, a foreshadowing of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. I try to think about his life and how he lived and walked and preached and loved and cared for. And then he finds himself in the garden less than 24 hours away from his death and a horrible crucifixion. And as he sits there and he prays to God, he says, God, if this cup can pass from me, I pray that it does. But not my will, thy will be done. Lord, search me. I give my heart, I give my life to you. It's that transformational moment where we yield ourselves to the will and the design of the God that loves us. That's prayer. That's prayer, having that willingness to get to that place and yield ourselves to the God who's leading and guiding. All of the stuff that we're seeing in front of us, none of it surprises him. But if we would engage him and we would allow him to maybe bring us along on that journey, maybe none of it would surprise us. And today, as we close out this message, and in just a moment, we're gonna transition into communion. Maybe you're logged on today and you've not had a moment to really bow your heart and choose to believe, to allow your faith to come alive, to choose to believe in Jesus as the expression, as the gift of God to humanity. You know, it wasn't enough for God to just watch humanity implode and to just melt to the ground. He sent his son to create a connecting point back. And that son walked this earth and taught us a better way. This is why we talk about our mission being connecting people to Jesus, because Jesus taught us how to love, how to care for, how to represent God in a better way to this world. And today you can simply say, God, maybe I don't understand it all, but I choose to believe in my heart that your son Jesus was that gift. Now help me to learn and help me to grow and maybe understand what that means as I believe in him. And I invite you, if you will, in this moment, for all of us, just to pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you for this moment and just the opportunity to incline our hearts collectively. But Lord, personally, you know the issues we're struggling with. You know what we're walking through. And I pray, Lord, that you would help us to deal with those areas that seem to attack us at every single turn. Help us to push through and get that junk out of our lives that just seems to hang around. No more complacency. No more just allowing things to be there because we just are comfortable with them. Lord, help us to get them out because we invite you into the searching process. And God, for those who maybe have never had a chance to believe that today would be the day, by just simply saying inside of our hearts, Jesus, be my Lord, be my Savior. God, we love you, we trust you. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now, as we transition into a time of communion, I invite you, if you will, to go ahead and get your elements together. Nate and Micah, if you wanna come on in. You know, it always amazes me when we take communion that over 2,000 years ago, Jesus gathered together with his disciples around a table. And what he had present to him was bread. It would have looked a little different, but wine or fruit of the vine. And I can imagine him sitting back and thinking, I need a way to connect for these disciples to remember. And so he does something that to this day still just blows me away. He offers them something in that moment and asks them to remember. And do you know, 2,000 years later, we have the same opportunity. Through bread and through juice, we can connect our hearts back to that particular moment and we can remember the God that loves us. And I hope maybe that speaks to your heart today as you think about that. It was on the night that he was betrayed. Where Jesus, I can imagine, like I said, he looked at his disciples and he thought, I've gotta give them something. And so he takes bread and he gives thanks and then he breaks it. And he turns and he gives it to his disciples and he says, this is my body, which is broken for you. As often as you eat, do so in remembrance of me. And then in the same manner, he took the cup and he said, this cup represents a new covenant for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink, do so in remembrance of me. And I think his hope would have been that even though they didn't know in that particular moment, that later they would remember. And I'm gonna tell you they did, because we wouldn't be talking about it if they didn't. And so today, remember Jesus, the life that was given, the blood that was shed for your healing. And I'm just gonna go ahead and say right up front, today, Nate, I know you're here, I drug you in here. We send Nate off to college tomorrow. Tammy and I are going to jump in the truck and you're going to follow us in your little sled. And we're taking him to Birmingham, to Huntington College, to set him in ministry school. And you're going to start on this fun journey. And I'm thinking about all the families out there that are doing the same thing. I've seen you at Walmart buying refrigerators, buying stuff, getting ready to send your kids to college as well as to put them in school. And I'm a hot mess. Tammy's a hot mess. Nate's excited. I think he's been ready to go for a long time. So as I pray this prayer, I want you to know that I'm praying for him. I'm praying for you. Let's pray. Lord, we offer you this time. God, and for all the families that are struggling, sending their kiddos out, going back into school. There are some families that are just thinking about and remembering. Maybe their kids are full grown with families of their own. Lord, we trust you and we love you. And our lives are so interesting with so many twists and turns. And as we think about this bread and we think about this cup, Lord, all of it is gathered together around you, your Son, Jesus, because this is where we get life. And so today, whatever our lives look like, we anchor it right here in these two sacraments because they remind us of your Son, Jesus. Not because of the sacrament, but because of your Son, Jesus. And so today we pray a blessing on each person for peace, for strength, for healing. God, we love you. We trust you. And it's in your Son, Jesus' name we pray, amen. Now I invite you, if you will, to go ahead and serve those that are there with you around the living room while we play this this final song. Well, I hope you've had a great Sunday today. We look forward to just praying and believing that this week is going to be awesome for you. And so with that, let's send you out. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We love you. Lead us and guide us. It's going to be a crazy week this week. And it's in you that we trust. We love you. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You guys have a great week. Thank you.